Starting at East 96th Street and stretching all the way to the East Harlem River, El Barrio is an area rich in culture, community, and history. We aim to take a deeper look into how the neighborhood has changed after all these years and how it's still changing today.
One of the explanations for how the neighborhood was changing that I heard often when I was researching was, oh, you know, change is natural. It's this thing that happens all the time. This is a Puerto Rican neighborhood now. It used to be an Italian neighborhood. So what kind of if it's going to be now a neighborhood of wealthier white residents? And one of the things that I found when I was researching the neighborhood was that the ethnic groups, yeah, had changed, right? It was Puerto Rican predominantly. Now we're seeing more Mexicans, right? And before Puerto Ricans, it was largely Italians. And before that, you had Germans and Jews and Irish folks who were all here. But what I found in my research was that while that was true, really from like the late 1800s, though, this was a working class community, right? Like this was a community where, yes, you had all these different ethnic groups who now we would consider to be more white. At the time when they came, Irish were certainly not considered to be fully white. Germans and Jews, right, were viewed in different ways than they are contemporaneously, right? So like, that was one of the things I realized, that this kind of excuse for a lot of the displacement we've been seeing as being kind of this natural ethnic shift was actually missing the fact that for so long, irrespective of the different nationalities that were here, this neighborhood had been one of the few places that working class people could actually afford to live in this city.
El Barrio Latino is very well known even outside the country. I'm from Colombia, and over there you hear East Harlem, El Barrio Latino, the Latino part of New York.
Back in the 1930s, El Barrio had the largest Italian population in all of the United States. It was only a decade later when it was given the nickname Spanish Harlem due to the rapid influx of the Latinx population. However, you can still see the Italian influence around the neighborhood.
What's your experiences in the neighborhood?
My experience, I came away in 1950 and I'm still here.
One such place lies on 116th Street, a small hole-in-the-wall barbershop that's been around for over 70 years. The owner,
Claudio Caponigro,
reminisces on his life here in El Barrio with one of his regular customers.
One time I used to be here, you know, almost all the time, and now we're international. We got the black, the Spanish, the Asians, the Jewish, everybody now. And with me, equal right, everybody.
Claudio treats everybody the same.
The same.
The same. A lot of actors came from this neighborhood too. I think Burt Lancaster came from here, Claudio. Burt Lancaster. Was he? Him? A few other. My wife tells me. Because, like I say, she was born here. Claudio knows her when she was born.
She was born. How old is your wife now?
60.
I remember when she was born.
Born. Right, right, right.
I was a family friend with her.
That's right. I don't have to worry about a barber for the rest of my life because I don't think I'll make it. Claudio will make it.
While El Barrio clearly has an interesting past, it's important that we also focus on the present and, along with it, the future. What was once an area for low-income families is slowly being taken over by fancy condos and high-rise apartments. Focus is placed solely on those condos rather than developing more shelters and parks. What does this mean for the residents of El Barrio? A new opportunity or a new cause for concern?
Whether we're talking about, large portions of the arts sector here kind of being erased or sanitized as the neighborhood begins to gentrify, or tenants associations fighting to try and get repairs done and remain in their community. You know, these are all things that people have experienced and see every single day here. So I think that the film connected with folks for that. It connected with folks, and I think it was appreciated because it was relatable. And it opened up a space for people to have conversations about the changes that we were seeing without having to have it be tied to a specific remedy that we're all rallying for. Not that that isn't valid, but I think that it offered an opportunity to try and reimagine and think of things in a different way and ask, is what we're doing working?
Me and my roommates moved here because we just finished college and we ended up needing somewhere in New York City. I mean, we could have picked anywhere throughout Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan, Bronx, wherever you wanted to go, but we chose East Harlem because a lot of our friends lived in West Harlem. And we saw it was pretty cool up there, so we thought East Harlem would be kind of the same thing. But it's completely different. El Barrio is very different from West Harlem, in a good way, in my opinion, because travel convenience is a big thing for us, and living on the East Side is so easy, because getting to the Bronx, to Queens, Brooklyn, it's so easy. Same thing with downtown, midtown. Just the convenience of being here is really, really good. And besides that, I really like the fact that knowing I live here is I'm in New York City and I'm in Manhattan, but it doesn't have that big city feel to it. I didn't really think I would like it as much as I did. I thought it was kind of just a place I'd live in. It would be just convenient for me travel-wise and work-wise, but in all reality, I feel a lot more connected to the community than I thought I would. They take you in really quickly. They make you feel like one of them, which is something I really enjoy.
Some of the rents at Lexington Gardens and a lot of other affordable housing developments throughout the neighborhood will be as low as $300 or $400 or $500. But that's a really small percentage of the units that are actually in that building. You've got a lot of other rents in there that are at a spectrum, right? So some will maybe be $1,000, $2,000. In many of these affordable housing developments, like we might call them that, but like they're predominantly market rate. And so you'll see rents that are $3,000 maybe a month in those same buildings. So what we're focused on, obviously, is the small percentage of affordable housing. How do we get that? How do we qualify for that? Which are all valid questions. You know, you see an affordable housing development open up, it's got 20 units, you could see 50,000 applications, right? Because that's the type of need that there is. But yeah, so they'll, of course, I mean, that's always the tagline that you see. You more often than not, you will see an article talking about how low the rents are in this brand new development. What they don't put in the big header is that it's only going to be like 10 units, as opposed to like the however many hundred are in that building. And they less often explain that like there are also rents in that building that are far, far higher than what the neighborhood can actually afford. The average median income of East Harlem is somewhere around $31,000, $32,000 a year for a household. The vast majority of housing that's being built in East Harlem is not affordable to those families. And that's the vast majority of the affordable housing being built. Obviously the market rate housing is completely out of the range of those families. But the vast majority of the affordable housing is not actually affordable to them. Because when we talk about affordable housing in New York, the affordability ranges are defined not by this neighborhood, not by this zip code. They're defined by the average median income of the of not just all five boroughs, but some outlying counties as well. So when we hear affordable housing, we think, oh, that's great, X number of units will be affordable. But we also have to ask that question of like, affordable for who? Define affordability. And it's very rare that when we're even saying affordable housing, that it is affordable to the neighborhood that it's being built in, and affordable to the folks who are being pressured out by that very development. You see a lot of stretches of 2nd and 3rd and 1st Avenue that are going to be opened up for far taller development.
Even to those who don't live here, El Barrio has managed to make a name for itself.
El Barrio feels very neighborhood, very homey. New York is a big city. And usually everybody's minding themselves, their own business. Like you can walk in Manhattan or Queens or Brooklyn and nobody's gonna say anything to you. But here at El Barrio, I find something very interesting. Like you're walking around and you see people talking to each other the way you don't see it in other parts of New York at all. And actually for me, it's quite a surprise. Like a couple of times I have been walking behind this guy and somebody bumps up him and you're like, oh, is this gonna be a fight? Because that's what you tend to think. And no, they are friends. They are just like, you didn't pay attention that I was coming. What's up, my man? Start like talking, friends. And that's something you feel only here at El Barrio. Like you can feel in the corners, people talking to each other. You can hear a lot of, hey buddy, how are you? That's very El Barrio style. That's something I haven't experienced in other boroughs or neighborhoods around New York. And I feel it's a reflection of the Latino culture. It's something I will find more at home. But it's also very interesting because I will do that to my closest people. But here in El Barrio, it's like you can feel that everybody had that sense of community, of living close to each other or knowing each other.
each year, more and more people have been affected by El Barrio's constant renovations, which added new buildings and businesses. As a result, landlords and building owners have increased their rent. What was once a community of local business owners seeking a new life has instead become an area populated by younger, wealthier business owners. The unemployment rate in El Barrio is twice that of the overall unemployment rate in Manhattan.
So right now in East Harlem, you see large swaths of 1st, 2nd, and 3rd Avenue in Lexington, right, being offered up to private developers to build taller and denser. The city wants to do that in hopes of building affordable housing, hoping that some portion of those now far taller and denser buildings will be affordable units. Affordable to whom is up for debate, right? But most of those units are going to be market rate units. And so we're going to see, the city is hoping to allow developers to build 10, 20, 30 stories, in many cases, allowing them to do that in areas where there are already existing 4 to 5 story walk-ups. And so what that does is if you begin to allow development, X percentage higher than the current development that's there, right? If you got a 4-story walk-up and you start to allow developers to, in a hypothetical world, right, build 20 stories, you incentivize the demolition of that building. Because now the property owner has a piece of property that is worth far more, right? You can do a lot more with that property, and they have a lot more incentive now to displace the tenants that are there. Yeah, they might face penalties. They might face fines. They might have bad press. But is it really gonna be enough to stave off the windfall that they're now being offered by the city? So it's this complicated game. It's like you want affordable housing, and this seems to be the only way to do it in this market, but much of those plans are actually further incentivizing the displacement of folks who are living in 4 and 5 story walk-ups that have been here 30, 40, 50, 60, 80 years.
El Barrio has a lot happening that is affecting the community, requiring our immediate focus. Along with this, there are also big changes coming to this neighborhood soon that are worth noting. While a few people are optimistic, some residents are a little more skeptical. Residents of El Barrio are being pushed out of their apartments due to new housing projects.
With the gentrification, I see like a lot of stores like closing and opening or just moving around. With the rent going up, it pushes out people that can't really afford to stay here.
I have a firm stance that when you put new things into areas and kind of rebuild on it, it's a good thing. It's refreshing it, it's making it better, because there are definitely, you walk around and there are definitely buildings and structures that do need to be redone. But I think it's personally a positive thing seeing these new buildings going up.
Current residents in El Barrio are unhappy with the government over these projects, believing that they are being driven out of their homes. Only time will tell if the government will listen to the people's demands or press onward with their projects regardless.
Actually, I have had thoughts about that because, well, my work is based on El Barrio right now, and I have felt that it would be very interesting to be in the neighborhood. So definitely it's a thought I have had. The only reason I haven't done it yet is more like the money part, the economical part, because finding a rent, an affordable rent, is quite a situation right now in El Barrio. But definitely, I will do it.